This week, redefining disability, how the whole person is helping people lead independent lives and changing attitudes about the disabled across the metro.
We talk with one of the city's most respected PR gurus. He's been at the top of his game. He even drives race cars, and he's totally blind.
And we get a behind-the-scenes look at Quality Hill Playhouse, an intimate theater that plays host to musicals and cabaret reviews of catchy classics from musical theater and the American Songbook.
Principal funding for the local show provided by Francis Family Foundation, William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank Trustee, Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kaufman Foundation, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Paul Family Foundation, Johnson County Community College. Additional support provided by and Kcpt members. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Nick Haynes.
And I'm Randy Mason, and welcome to The Local Show. If you are disabled and living in Kansas City, chances are good you know all about the whole person.
The nonprofit agency started in 1978 at a time when the rights of the disabled to hold jobs and gain access to public buildings were poorly protected.
Their early achievements included helping persuade the Kansas City Area Transportation Authority to equip new buses with wheelchair lifts and improve physical access to polling places.
For more than 30 years, the whole person has been a local leader in representing people with disabilities. But as you're about to see in this profile from producer Rich Miller, they're also engaged in dozens of direct services that allow thousands of people with disabilities all across the metro lead independent lifestyles.
The Whole Person is a fantastic organization. We do a lot of peer counseling. A lot of our services are geared around the needs of people with disabilities who want to achieve or maintain independent living circumstances. We're all about empowerment and helping people succeed.
We've got to get the public to understand that people with disabilities are just that, people, just like everybody else who happen to have disabilities.
One of our missions at The Whole Person is to make sure that people with disabilities have a chance to be seen as contributing members of society, as taxpayers, as people who are not dependent, but who are in control of their own lives and their own destinies.
Well, I think the biggest thing they know is if you're someone with a disability, you don't have to be just sitting at home, not doing anything. We have people with all sorts of disabilities doing things that they have a lot of fun with.
I live an active lifestyle. By that, I do just about what anybody else has done or doing. A lot of times I do it differently. Like I dress myself. A lot of people, when they see it, they're like, whoa, that's cool. Here's my coat. A lot of times life is just figuring out what you want and how to get there, and it doesn't have to look like everybody else's story. I drive a car, no special controls on my vehicles. Freaks people out. And so when I'm driving, this is pretty much my little setup here. I got an extension because I'm short. That's about all it is, and I operate it like this.
When Centers for Independent Living were first visualized, this concept, which we call consumer control, was a fundamental part of the beginning of Centers for Independent Living. And you don't find, and I'm not aware of a whole lot of other social service agencies, or maybe even any social service agencies, that are run by the people they're designed to help. And I think that's a very unique concept, and it's something that says that the best expert on a disability is not necessarily a doctor, not necessarily a nurse, not necessarily a social worker, but a person who is actually living successfully with a disability.
You know, someone who's had a recent accident, and life is going to be different, unfortunately, forever. But there's life after accidents. And so a lot of the peer counseling allows us to show others that, hey, there is a future, there is opportunity. Life is different in one sense, but life does not have to be different in the sense of setting goals and having success.
We don't go in and tell them what to do. We actually help the consumer learn how to do that. So eventually we're trying to work ourselves out of a job. We also do independent living skills training, which is someone might want to learn how to cook in their own home. They might want to know what kind of adaptive equipment is best to do in their home and then how to use that equipment. They might want to learn how to use the bus system. And so we go out and we help them to learn that. Budgeting. It's only limited by what the person wants to do.
Sydney wanted to tell mom, she wanted to tell her everything. She wanted to do things, and it was so hard coming home from school and running around and couldn't tell mom what she wanted. She's pointing, screaming, crying, mom's screaming at her, and now it's she's just a totally different kid.
Whenever you have a child with a disability, especially a communications disability, that's almost overwhelming. And taking that sign language and moving it into the home and then teach the family. That's who needs to learn.
I mean, I love it that the communication between us is better. Because it was, I mean, I was stressed. I was.
Taking a child that, you know, was, you know, screaming because she didn't have a way to tell her mom, I'm hungry, or I'm tired, or, you know, I really want, you know, that Barbie doll. And now she is, and mom is communicating. And they're like, you know, it's like this, I don't know, it's like this bridge that's been built. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the best part of my job, is seeing that bridge of communication built.
There are thousands of people in nursing homes that want to get out. I don't know anybody that really, really wants to go into a nursing home. Look at all the older people who are becoming, as they grow older, they find that their homes are no longer accessible to them, right? It's a little bit harder to walk up those steps. And we're not prepared for it. We have the whole baby boomer population. They're going to have to move out of their homes. The homes they've lived in for 20, 30, 40 years are no longer accessible. And we need to be thinking about that. The whole person has been serving the Kansas City area for more than 30 years. And we rented on many different places in town and finally decided we need our own space.
Right now, we're kind of scattered between satellite offices in Gladstone, Independence, here, as well as Prairie Village. But in a year and a half or so from now, we'll be in our own building, and that will be that's one thing we're all looking forward to being all in one place. It makes a much better team spirit, a much better efficiency in terms of all of us working together and seeing each other all the time versus on the phone or email or things like that.
You could go down this hallway and find any number of people who have had any number of setbacks, any number of things that might have daunted a lesser person. But I think if you're going to look at the story of the whole person, the essence of what the whole person is, we're survivors. We're not going away. We're people with disabilities who are not going to ever, ever give up. And I think that is the fundamental heart of who we are and what Centers for Independent Living do.
I'm done.
Learn more about the whole person and how to contact its four offices in Kansas City, Prairie Village, Independence, and Gladstone at our webpage, thelocalshow.org.
For decades, he was the man to go to when major public figures or institutions in our metro had a really bad PR problem and they needed crisis management. If they wanted the best, they turned to David Westbrook, founder and CEO of the Corporate Communications Group.
Westbrook hit the top of his game and was named PR Executive of the Year in Kansas City. He's highly sought after on a slew of corporate and nonprofit boards. For fun, he drives race cars. Oh, and by the way, did I fail to mention he is totally blind? Local show guest host Cynthia Wheeler Linden sat down with Westbrook, who's now Vice President of Strategy and Innovations at Children's Mercy Hospital.
you're one of Kansas City's best kept secrets in terms of communication. You started off at the Shawnee Mission School District, and you also built a huge corporation called Corporate Communications Group. Can you tell us a little bit about your communication experience?
Well, you know, I was really, really lucky when I was at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. I had the privilege of being in the student government there, and we created the Robert F. Kennedy Memorial Symposium, which enabled us to invite huge luminaries who were thought leaders in the late 1960s to come to the campus, many of whom were communications magnates, people in advertising and public relations and political advice, political consulting. And those folks gave me a chance to get a glimpse at a career that could be exciting. And so when I graduated from the university, I went to the Shawnee Mission School Superintendent and asked him for a job. He was a fellow who had gone across the bridge at Remagen during World War II, and a landmine had blown off his left leg just below his knee. He was told he would never make anything of his life, but he became a school superintendent. He looked at me, a blind guy who had no job and was trying to find a job. And he said, "I think I'll hire you. I don't know what you're going to do with your job, but you'll figure it out." He said, "I figured it out," and I guess I was given the chance to figure it out. The school district became a place where I could start my career, and from there got opportunities to do consulting work and eventually started my own company. Corporate Communications Group was a wonderful firm that I was able to own and operate for over 30 years. I was happy to sell it to the Trizzolo Communications Group, and my folks are working there and the clients are happy, and I am thrilled to be at Children's Mercy Hospital, which is a marvelous institution. And my job, ironically, is to help them define their vision for a future, which is going to be a really challenging time for healthcare, for our economy, and for huge changes that are going to take place in both. So
you seem to spend a lot of time working on projects that seem to encompass children. First, it was the Shawnee Mission School District. I'm not sure if many of our viewers know, but you are a co-founder of the Partnership for Children. What motivates you to do the type of work you do as it relates to focusing on children?
Well, ironically, I don't have children myself, my own family. But I think the way we treat our children today sends a signal to a generation of people we'll never meet. And I believe strongly that the children of our community are the conscience of our community. And by that I mean that the way we treat our kids is a real expression of the way we regard ourselves. And so I think it's extremely important for us to take care of young people, because that is the best way to protect our democracy, to protect the viability of our community, and to protect the well-being of those children as they grow into adults in the future. You know, in healthcare, at Children's Mercy, we represent only 10% of the entire patient population of the nation, but we represent 100% of the future. Anytime you make an investment in the health of a child, you're going to get a return. I can tell you, you make an investment in my health or somebody else's health who's at the other end of the spectrum, you're not going to get much of a return.
Well, then someone obviously made a really big investment on you when you were a young child. You are blind.
Right.
And you have found yourself in really unique positions and with the opportunity to help advance sort of things for other individuals who struggle with either blindness or other disabilities.
Well, you know, I was privileged when I was young to have adversity early in life. And I think when you have that happen, you get a chance to understand what life is all about. For me, I've come to believe that no challenge is ever greater than the resources we've been given by nature, or maybe by a power greater than ourselves, to manage those challenges. I'm not necessarily a religious person. I do have a spiritual life. And I think that my blindness has given me far more than it's taken away from me. It gave me a chance to come into contact with parts of myself that I probably would have never met, talents I probably never would have nurtured, and to get a chance to be helpful to other people when they're faced with issues that I was faced with earlier in life, and can maybe help them along as others helped me along when those challenges were facing me. So I don't look at, you know, life is not something to be victimized by or conquer and control. It's something to be experienced on a daily basis, and I happen to like doing that. I think it's a happy thing to do.
You have faced many challenges, and I can relate to some of those, but have you had, when you left college and you started looking for work, was it difficult? Did people close doors in your face when you said, "Here's my degree, this is what I want to do," or "This is what I'm interested in," or were you lucky enough to walk into Shawnee Mission and not have a door closed?
I would like to say it's a combination of providence and strong effort. I was interviewed by a corporate leader in 1970. This was before the American Disabilities Act and not too long after the Civil Rights Act had been adopted. So the fashion was to ask some questions that are today absolutely politically unacceptable. And this one fellow asked me, well, you've done very well in college, but if we hired you, how would you go to the bathroom and read your mail?
And I don't know. How would you know?
Well, I wanted to ask him at the same time, but I didn't want to be that irreverent. So, you know, I had to develop skills, I think, early in my life to figure that those questions are not born out of wickedness or meanness. They're born at worst out of ignorance. And that my opportunity is to educate people about how blindness is not a handicap, but instead just a quality that I bring to my life that changes a little bit, but doesn't make it impossible for me to do things that sighted people can do.
So driving your race car and, you know, taking those ski jumps, those slopes in Aspen, they're not a problem.
I would never get on a set of snow skis. I think the blind people who do that have a multiple handicap. I think they're crazy too. But I would admit that I have occasionally driven my car in the parking lot and once out at the speedway. And you know, you could do those things if you're devoted to it.
So was it fun? And next time you do it, can I come along for the ride?
If you'll promise not to say the rosary in the back seat, like the last occupant of mine did that.
David, I want to thank you for taking time out to sit down and talk to me.
Thank you very much for this opportunity myself.
Our Perform Arts series, in conjunction with Studio Magazine, is an effort to spotlight some of the groups and troupes around town doing outstanding work in music, theater, and the arts. This week, Randy Mason takes you downtown to learn more about the Quality Hill Playhouse.
The story of the Quality Hill Playhouse is inextricably linked to the story of this well-dressed man, J. Kent Barnhart. Raised in Raytown and trained at UMKC's Conservatory of Music, Kent eventually came face to face with the realization that very few classical pianists can make a living at it. So in the 1980s, he turned his attention to musical theater. And in short order, found himself backing actors on stages all over town.
Well, that's the way it goes. Play this.
Within a few more years, he'd created a small show of his own, Strictly Cole Porter with Deb Ossimus. It played here in several incarnations before moving on to a run in New York City. When Kent came back from the Big Apple, he learned that one of his favorite spaces was up for grabs. He took the plunge and took the reins. And since 1995, has been making the little theater beneath the parking garage Kansas City's home for something close to but not quite cabaret.
Mosquitoes, a heaven forbid, do it. So does every Katie did do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
Our shows are sort of a hybrid. In New York, a cabaret is usually 45, 60 minutes long, costs $100. It's one singer. Our shows are two-act shows, more informative, more humorous. And also, we're in a theater, people are quiet, there's no smoking, there's no drinking. People are here to pay attention.
It doesn't matter how sincere it is,
nor how heartfelt the spirit. Sentiment will not endear it. What's important is the prize.
Here you have to be a soloist, but you also have to be a great musician, be able to blend, be able to sing four-part harmony, be able to act, because we don't just sing songs, we tell stories through songs. I take great care in putting the evening together so that it has a flow to it, but also so that there's an educational component to it. I talk about the songs and their origins and things that I think illuminates them and makes them fresh and new. It is unique, and once people experience it, they are a part of it, because we only have seven rows. I talk to them. They feel like they know me. They feel like they know the performers. And it's a home to them in a way that a larger theater isn't. part of our mission is that we only hire Kansas City artists, people who choose to live in Kansas City. We don't ever audition out of town. We don't hire people who live out of town. So over the years, they get to see how they've grown as performers and get to know them that way.
It's a process that works both ways, according to the Piano Man. With over 2,000 season ticket holders and a room that only seats 150 at a time, the audiences for each particular night, he says, have developed a personality of their own. But they all come expecting a crisp, fast-paced show that's been polished, polished, and polished some more.
Well, I think if you would ask anyone with whom I've worked, expressing my expectations is not difficult for me. People are pretty clear about what I expect. I mean, people joke about it, but I mean, I am a perfectionist. I'm not ever completely satisfied with myself, with the product, with anything. But at the same time, when it comes time to open the show, you let go of that. I mean, 90% of it is the people you hire. If you hire the right people, then you're set.
Something that Barnhart is nothing but happy about are the major improvements a few years back that virtually revamped not only the theater, but the lobby, the dressing rooms, and maybe most importantly, the restrooms.
Helix and J.E. Dunn did a magnificent job. It truly is a beautiful facility. In all modesty, it's more beautiful than any off-Broadway theater I've ever seen.
So what began as one man's vision has become an artistic enterprise that just keeps humming along, putting local talent to work and bringing 35,000 people a year downtown for some quality entertainment.
To get paid to do what you love to do is amazing. We jokingly talk about it being our living room. I mean, it's like salon concerts of 100 years ago. I mean, people just come over and we share music and have a great time. Let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it. Let's
fall in love. KCPT Public Television is 50 years old. As we mentioned last week, in the spirit of turning 50, we recently invited 50 of our viewers to tell us what KCPT means to them. Our only request, can you write it on this sign with this marker pen in 5 words or less? The only exception to the rule, figure out a way to show your 5 words more creatively. Here are some of the responses from your friends and neighbors as we recorded them around the metro.
To the mystery. This is
What does KCPT mean to you? Can you tell us in 5 words or less, on a sign, or in some other creative way? Send a link to your video or email us a photo at the Local Show website, thelocalshow.org. We'll show you more of these on next week's program. I'm Nick Haynes. We'll see you next time on The Local Show.
Principal funding for The Local Show provided by Francis Family Foundation, William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank Trustee, Frederick and Louise Hartwig Family Fund, Kaufman Foundation, Healthcare Foundation of Greater Kansas City, Hall Family Foundation, Johnson County Community College. Additional support provided by and KCPT members. Thank you.